Welcome to another week of Frinton Gospel Chapel online service. It's great to have you with us, especially if you're new to us or you're returning as a new visitor. It's great that you've come back. This morning, we're going to have our usual run of things. We're going to have a time of worship. We're going to spend some time in prayer and we're going to share communion together. So have your bread and wine or whatever you have with you ready, and we're going to do that. We're also going to be hearing from Ian Harrison, who will be bringing our message, and we're going to have a very quick update from Alex and Tori Bryant, who will also be leading us in a song of worship later. So that will be great. Just before we begin, let's open in prayer. God, we thank you that we can still come together and that we can still be church, even though we're not in the same room. God, we want to meet with you this morning. We want to hear from you, and God, we want to lift you up. We want to raise you and praise you. Lord, be with us now. Amen. Okay, so let's hear from Alex and Tori.
Hello, Frinton Gospel Chapel. It's Alex and Tori from Toowoomba, Australia. We just wanted to say hi and give you a short update. Right now in Toowoomba with YWAM, things are a little bit on hold with the virus and stuff like that. We're healthy and we hope that you guys are healthy as well. But what we're doing right now, it pretty much is pretty stripped back. We're still doing music things. We're running a prayer room every day that we're posting online on Facebook via our Facebook page. And we're basically operating like little family groups. We're trying to grow with one another, be vulnerable and create some kind of accountability during this time. We're not really able to go outside other than just going to the different buildings, but we're thankful for what we have and how life is going here, and we hope that it's going well for you guys as well.
Yeah, so a couple of prayer requests that we have. The first one, a vision that has just been spoken over our base recently, has just been a vision that it's a season of pruning and rest, as well as intimacy and growth. And so we would just love prayer that us as a family and as a base here together in Toowoomba, that we would just dive headfirst into that and continue to dive deeper into that. Mm-hmm. Second prayer request that we have would be for a marriage, just that we would continue to grow in communication and in love for one another. We're coming into almost our second anniversary, which is crazy. So really exciting, but obviously we want to continue to grow and learn. Yeah. And we still have so much to grow and learn in. And lastly, just wisdom and how to continue to navigate this season that we're in with all of its ups and downs and unknowns, just like everyone else in the world, just continuing to know how to navigate that together.
Yeah, so thank you guys for all your love and support, all of your prayers. We do really appreciate it. It makes a huge difference. We'll be praying for you all as well. And if you have any prayer requests, please send them to us. We'd love to pray for you and be your body in this time. So thank you again. We love you all a lot, and goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in days. I want to praise the wonders of my love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. So shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Promise I had. Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Good morning, church family and friends. It's lovely to be able to be with you this way this morning. I miss you all, and when I think about how I miss you, I start to pray, and I've been praying that the Holy Spirit will be with all of us, giving us comfort, strength, wisdom and love, and that we will be a shining light to those around us, spreading peace and love and comfort. So it is with joy that I pray with you this morning. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for all you have done for us, for loving us and giving us your Spirit to comfort and strengthen us. Thank you for our wonderful church family and friends. Thank you that we can still do church in this way and reach more friends. God, we pray for those that can't join us this morning, that they will feel loved and know that they are not forgotten. Help us to support each other, equip us to see the needs of others and help where we can. God, I pray for the children and young people in our church, that they will know how much they are loved and how much we cherish them. Fill them with joy and peace. God, we also pray for those that are unwell, that you will bring peace and healing to them. We pray for our nurses, doctors and carers, that you will equip them and give them strength and peace. I pray you will strengthen your church, all your people across the world, to go out and share the good news and love, so more people will come to know you as their Saviour. And God, we thank you for Ian Harrison and the blessing he is. Thank you that we can hear your message through him today. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless and stay safe, everyone.
We're going to come to a time of communion now, but first let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be a reminder for us of the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you, and do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, and he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember that all that Jesus did, in him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once and for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and a cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Jesus took the bread and he broke it, and he said that this was to be a reminder of his body given and broken for each one of us. So we take the bread and we remember. After supper, he took the cup and he said that the wine was a reminder of his blood, which was shed for the remission of sin for each one of us. So we take this cup thankfully and with grateful hearts. Let's finish by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Everyone, hope you're all keeping safe and well. I know you'll be missing school, so I thought you'd like to see a science experiment. Here's a glass of blue water. It's just ordinary tap water with blue food colouring so you can see it. Now I'm going to add something. So if I add this, Wow, look, it's changed colour. It's now the same colour as my top. There's nothing special about this. It's actually lemon juice, just ordinary lemon juice, one of Aldi's specials. A tiny amount of that can make a big difference. And it's just like that with God. He can turn something ordinary into something extraordinary, just like this was blue and I've turned it pink. You might think there's not a lot you can do at the moment at home, but God can turn the something that you are able to do into something great. He can multiply it to have a much greater effect than you realise. You can give someone a smile. You can say a thoughtful word or do a kind deed. Lots of people are going shopping for others that can't get out. Even putting a rainbow in your window can make a difference to someone. It can make them feel less alone. So remember, God can turn any action of yours into something bigger. You don't know the effect that it might have on someone. So try and remember that this week. Keep on doing what you're doing. Keep safe. And hopefully we'll be together again soon.
Well, hi everyone, it's Ian here. It's a real privilege to be sharing God's word with you this morning. I've been looking at your online Sunday services over the past couple of weeks and I congratulate everyone involved. They're brilliant. God has given you some amazing gifts in your church. So thank you all. We live in an age of anxiety. Every day, the newspapers and the TV bring us more and more headlines that fuel anxiety about the truly awful coronavirus. I think we're desperate as a society to find peace in these extraordinary times when the future is so uncertain in so many ways. And so my question this morning is simply this: where can you find real peace in the best sense of the word in times like this? God has given us in the Bible a whole book of worship songs, which contain songs that reflect every mood and feeling that you may have. It's called the Book of Psalms. And in the Book of Psalms, there's a whole set of songs that address this very theme of peace. They have this deep peace running through them. Peace is the ink that these psalms are written with. That's how deeply they speak of peace. And one of the best and the most famous is Psalm 23. I'm going to read it to you now. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And Psalm 23 shows us three things about how we can really experience peace. And the first thing is this: we can have peace because of a real God. Having real peace at times like this is not just a question of relaxing for relaxation's sake. It's not becoming inward looking. It's about becoming upward looking to the real God. That's where real peace comes from. And that's what David found. And that's what comes through the words of this psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. It's because the Lord is my shepherd. That's why I can rest. It's because of God. And because God is real, that's why I can rest, says David. We may think we're wandering through life on our own, but, says the writer of this psalm, there's someone who watches over us, who can help us, who can be a shepherd to us. And if this was written by David, who was king of Israel, he's saying in the first line of this psalm, I'm just a sheep. God is the shepherd. Isn't that an incredible thing for a monarch to say? Someone is in charge of my life, says David. From the big picture to the tiny details, someone's in charge of my life and it's not me. And whoever it is that's in charge of my life, he makes me lie down and just rest. That's how it works, says David. If you want real peace is not an escape. You know, wouldn't it be great to get away from it all? Let's fly away and leave it all behind. That's not real peace because the problems are still there. Real peace isn't putting your fingers in your ears saying, now I have real peace because I can't hear any stress. That's not real peace. Real peace in this psalm is in surrender. Real peace is when God is the shepherd, you are the sheep, and you let go. That's where peace comes from. When the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. And he makes me lie down, and that's where I get my peace from. And so here's the question that this psalm puts to us. Who is your shepherd? Do you have a shepherd? Or is it you? Who is your God? Let me run this principle past you. I wonder if you agree with this. Whoever is God gets no sleep. Whoever is God gets no sleep. Being God is a big job. We agree. So whoever is God has got a lot to do. That person gets no sleep. And in another one of the Psalms of Peace, there's a whole set of these Psalms. This is the theme that comes through in Psalm 121, which says this, the one who watches over me will neither slumber nor sleep. God who watches over you, God never sleeps. And because God never sleeps, you can sleep. You see how it works? And that's what David's saying in Psalm 23. He makes me lie down. So whoever is God gets no sleep. And if Yahweh, the God of the Old Testament, if he is God, then we can rest. But flip it round. What if we are God? What if we are the boss? What if we don't want God to be God? And we insist on taking control and making all the big decisions and making sure everything's all right around us? What if that's the responsibility we put on ourselves? Well then, whoever is God gets no sleep. And if you're acting like God, then rest will be hard to find. Isn't it true that some of us can't relax and find peace because we are the shepherd of our own lives? Isn't it true that some of us can't sleep because we are God? And God is there on the fringes. And he's saying, I would love for you to trust me. I saw a poster a little while ago, and it said this. Don't feel totally, personally, irrevocably responsible for everything. That's my job. Signed, God. The second thing I would call real power. How do these Psalms of Peace work? And what I want to suggest to you is that these Psalms are not just words. They're also deeds. If you want to get really technical, they could be called a speech act. That is, you're saying something, but it's much more than just saying something. In fact, it's barely a word at all. It's really a deed. You're actually doing something. It's not just you're communicating, you're accomplishing something by the act of speaking. A speech act. The words have power in them. Let me give you an example of this. Sometime in 1969, way back, a young man with hair said to Janet Margaret Lane, you light up my life. I want you to light up the rest of it. Will you marry me? Now, will you marry me doesn't mean, can you imagine some future situation in which you're my wife? That's not what it means. Will you marry me doesn't even mean, is it your intention that at some point we might, you know, get together in church with fancy clothes on? That's not what it means. It's more powerful than that. It's actually a giving. The moment you say your word, those words, you give of yourself. Will you marry me? And the moment when she eventually stopped crying, and you can read into that whatever you like, when she eventually stopped crying and said yes, that word had power. And it changed us from being boyfriend and girlfriend to be fiancé and fiancé. The word has power. It brings a new reality into being. And the words of the Psalms have power. When we say them and enter into them and let them go to work in us, they have power to actually bring new things into being. So, David says, I will fear no evil. And just to say those words, even though evil is still there, you get the sense in this psalm that it is still there, still David is changed. I will fear no evil. To say it has power. And this Psalm 23 is full of powerful, positive words. You ask David, David, are you a glass half full or a half empty kind of person? David will say, my cup overflows. That's the kind of outlook he's got. In Genesis, at the beginning of the Bible, God creates with a word. And God makes us in his image so that we're like him. So we also, with our words, have power to bring new things into being. A bit like the engagement. God promises himself to us. I'm your shepherd. I'm your guardian. I will never leave you. And when we make these psalms our own, we say, yes, I accept that promise. And it changes us. And it changes our situations. And by the way, these psalms of peace are not a guarantee that life will be easy. Sometimes we walk through the darkest valley, or in the old version, through the valley of the shadow of death. And you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and it's tough. And yet, the psalm says, you are with me. And because you're with me, I know I will not stay in this valley forever. I'm willing to take a step of faith. So, even though when you're in a valley and you can't see out of the valley, that's what valleys are like, still, because you are with me, I believe I will not stay in this valley forever. And therefore we say these psalms with their sort of sweet words and their wonderful promises, even though they are not yet true. Because of trusting God, we say them because we believe that one day they will be true. Somehow there's a truth in them that we can't see yet, but it's an act of faith in the goodness of God, even when we can't see it. Okay, one last thing. How do we know God will bring us through the valley? How do we know if we surrender control and let God be God, that he will actually bring us safely home? And here's the third thing. Real comfort. What is the comfort? Well, if you reflect on Psalm 23, and the more you chew over these verses that we know so well, the more you get the sense that whoever wrote these words knew because they had experienced God's goodness. They'd been through the testing time. I will fear no evil. You're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, this is interesting because the staff is like the shepherd's crook. It brings the sheep back in line and stay on course. And the rod It's like a beating stick. It's a weapon. And you might think, how's that a comfort? How's it a comfort to know that the shepherd is carrying a weapon? And that's where we need to think about it, because what David's reflecting on here is that the rod, you'll be pleased to know, the rod is not for the sheep. Okay, relax. The rod is not for the sheep. The rod is for the enemy of the sheep, for the lion and the wolves and the bears. The rod is to protect against any threat. And what David is saying is, thinking of myself as a sheep and the good shepherd, I look and see that this shepherd is willing to defend me. He's ready to protect me. He's willing to risk his life to protect me. And when I see that, I'm comforted. That's where my comfort comes from the shepherd who's willing to risk everything to defend me. So when Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd, you know, he also says, the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I want you to know that I am the good shepherd you can trust, says Jesus. Don't just take my word for it. Know this, that I will lay down my life for you. Any enemy that comes against you, I'll deal with it, says Jesus. Whether it's your own sin and you need guiding on the right path, whether it's death, whether it's Satan, whether it's all the mess and chaos and distractions of life, whatever comes against you, said Jesus, I want you to know that I will deal with it. And the sign, and actually the act of me dealing with it, will be that I lay down my life on the cross. One final thought. How do I connect with this peace? One little thought from the final verse, verse 6. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And that word follow literally means, if you want to enter into this imaginatively, it means chase after. So it says, surely I'm going this way and your goodness, God, and your love are chasing after me all the days of my life. And if that's so, if goodness and love are chasing after us, then if you want to experience that, if you want God's goodness to hit you, what's the only thing you need to do? It's stop, and it will. And that's how we pray these Psalms of Peace. We take a moment at the beginning of the day, the end of the day, whatever works for you. You step off the treadmill, whatever it is you're doing. You turn off all the distractions. You pick up God's word and you stop. And when we do that, God is waiting to meet us with his peace, with his protection in these difficult times. The real God who saves us in Jesus Christ. Amen.
You're beautiful. stars, it's so proclaiming who you are. You're beautiful.
Well, thank you again for being with us for another online service. We hope that you enjoyed it, and we hope that you'll come and join us again next week. Let's just close this service in prayer. God, we thank you for this time together, and we thank you for that message, and we pray that we will take that message to heart. God, would you be with us, and would you be in the conversations that we have throughout the week? Will you use us in mighty ways, in ways that we couldn't have dreamed you could use us in this kind of scenario? Amen. So, I'll see you again soon. Well, ish.